I invite you to listen to this music and take this time of reflection as we prepare for worship. Thanks for that, Scott. Doing such a great job filling in as the organist. Welcome and good morning. Welcome to worship at the First Presbyterian Church of San Luis Obispo. Welcome to those of you who are here live, and welcome to those of you who will be watching the recording of this service later on. We're glad that you're here with us today. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we are going to rejoice and be glad in it. We're glad to have you with us today. It's Pentecost Sunday. This is historically, this is the birthday of the church. So I have been in places that sang happy birthday to the church. We may dispense with that today, but just know that I'm thinking that in my head. This is the day that we celebrate God's gift of the Holy Spirit that came and, as I said in my letter this week, empowered and emboldened the group of people who followed Jesus during his earthly ministry and helped them start the movement which became the Christian church in the world. So we celebrate that today. The prayers will reflect that. The message will be on that story from the second chapter of Acts. And we'll celebrate this day. You're all wearing red because part of the story is that flames of fire landed on the heads of all the disciples. We have no idea what that, if that singed them or if that was a danger thing, but we know that that's part of the story. And so we wear red on this day. So we'll probably get some screen grabs during the day to show just how much red we've got on our screen. But we worship today as a part of the church that began on Pentecost Sunday so long ago. And so with that in mind, let's join together in the unison prayer that we will use as our shared invitation to worship. Join me in prayer. Praise and glory to you, Creator Spirit of God. You make our bread the communion of Christ's body to heal and reconcile and to make us the body of Christ. You make our wine the communion of Christ's saving blood to redeem the world. You are truth. You come like the wind of heaven, unseen, unbidden. Like the dawn, you illuminate the world around us. You grant us a new beginning every day. You warm and comfort us. You give us courage and fire and strength beyond our everyday resources. Be with us, Holy Spirit, in all we say or think, in all we do, this and every day. Amen. Let's join in worship as we sing together. We're going to sing two songs from the more contemporary side of things. This is Amazing Grace and The Stand. If you can sing loud where you are without disturbing your neighbors, join in and sing these songs. Thank you.
But I
thanks to Scott and the worship team. I'm going to hand it over to Anna Carey, who's going to lead us in the prayer of confession this morning. There you go.
Good morning on this Pentecost. Let us join together in the prayer of confession. There will be a short time for silence, during which you may offer your private prayers to God. Altogether, Almighty God, you poured your Spirit upon gathered disciples, creating bold tongues, open ears, and a new community of faith. We confess that we hold back the force of your Spirit among us. We do not listen for your word of grace, speak the good news of your love, or live as a people made one in Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Transform our timid lives by the power of your Spirit, and fill us with a flaming desire to be your faithful people, doing your will for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. May the God of mercy, who forgives you all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen. Just a couple of announcements of the church besides happy birthday, church. That's our first announcement. We are continuing with our reopening plans, and our target date for reopening remains July 25th. As I've been saying, that allows us to work out some of our technical issues for live streaming. It also allows us to kind of wait and see what happens with other churches that open before us. And very honestly, and we've been transparent about this, it accommodates some vacations that were already pre-planned among church staff, not knowing when reopening might happen. So we're looking forward to that. We have run one sound check already live streamed to a select audience. We wouldn't have inflicted that on everybody. We're going to get better at that. And gradually, we will test drive a new system for delivering the worship service to people who are not yet comfortable coming back into face-to-face worship. So end of July is our target date. We're going to keep doing Zoom until then. As I look down, we've got 49 windows occupied today. So we continue to remain active as this connected community through Zoom. But I also recognize that we are anxious to be together face-to-face. So we're looking forward to that. Part of the reopening process means that there are some part-time jobs, 10 hours or less per week, that are available within the church. If you know a young person or a not so young person looking for part-time work, contact the office. Some of that is with some face-to-face ministry roles with kids and with young people, and other parts of those are technical, helping the tech staff with worship on Sunday morning, and also helping to take care of the building a little bit during the week to give Andrew one day off. So if you know somebody interested in that, we've got some Cal Poly folks looking for us too. We're gonna fill those positions as a part of the reopening process. I'm gonna hand it back to Anna, who is going to read our scripture reading for today.
Let us hear these words from the prophet Joel, chapter 2. and afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens and on earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom God calls. Having heard these words from Holy Scripture, let us join together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thanks, Anna. And hearing the creed reminds me that I forgot to plug my own class. So just a reminder that we will be gathering on Zoom together, 7 o'clock on Wednesday evenings for a class as we make a journey through the creeds. We did the Apostles' Creed last week. We're going to talk about the heretic Arius and the Nicene Creed this week. You don't want to miss that. It's really going to be good. So anyway, I'm going to hand it off now to Jen, who's got some words for the kids and for us.
Hi. Today is the 50th day after Easter, and we call it Pentecost Sunday. And it is also known as the birthday of our church. So this is how the story goes. The apostles were gathered with a bazillion other people because that's what they did for Pentecost. And all of a sudden, this huge wind came and started blowing really, really hard and really, really loud. And then these flames rose above the apostles' heads. It didn't burn them, but they were able to speak in foreign languages that they had never spoken in before, because there was a lot of people there and they spoke a lot of different languages. And this way, everybody could understand what was being said. So the Holy Spirit came and filled the apostles, and the Holy Spirit can fill us too. And the Holy Spirit enables us to be able to share our talents with everyone who we come in contact with. So we can be filled with the Holy Spirit, and we should share what that means with others. We don't have to be a roaring wind or flames above our heads, but we can still love God and then love people and share that love with others. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for filling us with the Holy Spirit and giving us the ability to share it in so many different ways to so many different people. And we're thankful for the birthday of our church. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks for that, Jen. Kind of wish I'd thought of the whole fan and flames thing. That would have been quite the Sunday here. So, as you've been hearing, this week we celebrate Pentecost, and I think as we think about what's going on in our community and in our own households and in our nation, we can see a whole range of celebrations coming. Right, reopening. Of the church, summer vacations, maybe even graduations this week and this month and next month, seeing friends and families and concerts, and maybe even our favorite waiters and waitresses at restaurants. So many celebrations are right around the corner, and some of them are big and some of them are small. Today is a big one. Whatever else is going on, Pentecost is such an important day in the life of the church. It's the beginning of the spread of the gospel of Jesus Christ beyond Jerusalem and over the centuries across the entire world. Pentecost is the day that is meant to unify all of us in Jesus Christ. During this season of health concerns and viruses and protective distancing, Pentecost gives us a chance to reflect on what God has done to draw all the nations of the earth together. That's the meaning of Pentecost. The gift of the Holy Spirit joins all of us into God's family, even as it preserves what makes us unique and different and precious. So for today, just for a moment, we're going to celebrate Pentecost. We're going to celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit and the birth of the church. We don't do this to escape from what's going on in the real world. We consider this the real world. We don't do this to escape. We do this to be reminded of what God has done to redeem and transform the world, even in these challenging times. What God has done to offer us another way of living. So those of you who know me, those of you who've joined me on these Wednesday evening studies and probably in about a quarter of the sermons that I've given here over the last year, if you know me, you know that my version of the Pentecost story begins with a history lesson. It begins with the story of Hellenization, which if you can think back to your Western Civ 1 class, you might know or remember what Hellenization was. This was the period when Greek language and culture had its greatest influence on the Western world. Here's how it happened. When Alexander the Great conquered his part of the world in the 4th century BC, he imposed the Greek language on everyone in his empire. For the history geeks among us, that's what we mean by Hellenization. Literally, Helena is Greek language in Greek. Alexander required a common language. It's even called Common Greek or Koine Greek. It's the language of the New Testament. The original documents of the New Testament were written in this Koine Greek that Alexander imposed on all of the known Western world at the time. As Alexander's empire spread from Greece to India and across the Near East all the way through North Africa, he left them with this one common language that they had to be able to speak in order to function in that wide economy, in that wide empire that he had created. Here's the important history detail of that. There has never been a more complete adoption of a culture in the history of the world, not before and not since. Even when the Romans finally conquered the Greeks 300 years later, they kept Greek language and culture as the language of the empire. The influence of Greek culture lasted until the fall of Constantinople, you might know it as Istanbul, in 1453. In other words, for about 1800 years, Greek was one of the dominant languages of that entire part of the Western world. Now, alongside that history story, you need to know a little bit about the Jewish diaspora. That all that is a fancy word for the story of migration of the Jewish people to other parts of the world. Jews have been moving around the Western world since the 7th century BC. That includes the Babylonian exile in the 6th century. They left for a whole range of reasons, just like immigrants now. Economic opportunity, to escape wars, and sometimes they simply stayed and made homes where they had been in exile. Tens of thousands of Jews settled in Egypt, but they spread to every other direction too. In the first century, just like now, in the first century, 90% of the world's Jews live outside of Judea, or what is now Israel. One result of this spreading out was that just about every Jew all over this diaspora, all over that region, from India all the way across North Africa through the Near East, every Jew in the diaspora could understand three languages. Thanks to Alexander, they knew Greek for public and commercial life. They used Hebrew in the synagogue. And then there was the language that they learned and they spoke in their region of the world, the language they spoke, or maybe their ancestors spoke before Alexander came to town. Even Jesus would have been able to speak Greek, Hebrew, and Aramaic, which was his local language. From Greece to India to the Near East and all the way across North Africa, each region had its own home language, the one they spoke before Alexander gave them Greek. It was the language of their families and their ancestors. It was their heart language. It was the one that was most tied to their history and family and their identity. This is the world Jesus came into. This is the world that the Holy Spirit comes into after Jesus' ministry. This is the world his disciples would have to navigate to begin to know how to spread the gospel and to grow the church. Okay, so with apologies to those of you who hate history, but with warmth towards those of you who love those twin stories of Hellenization and the way the Jewish people spread across the Western world, that gets us ready to hear the Pentecost story in a new way. Listen to this story. This is Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. Listen for the word of God this morning. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each one of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, the crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, aren't all of these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own languages. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They've had too much wine." God's word for us this morning. That is the amazing story of Pentecost. That's the story of that first day when the Holy Spirit came and rested tongues of fire on people's head and a great wind and all of this that happens. There are three parts of this story for us to look at today. The first part is when the day of Pentecost came, when the 50th day after the resurrection of Jesus came, they were all together in one place. Now, for us on previous Pentecost Sundays, we might pass this part by. But after the year we've just had, it is so important they were all together in one place. We have probably taken that one for granted over the years, but now that we can't gather in churches for a while, now that we can't be together in one place, this part of the story pops out at me. 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead and a week or two after Jesus disappeared into the clouds, the earliest Christians were gathering and sharing meals and wondering what was going to happen. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And that brings us to the second part of the story, the coming of the Holy Spirit. Whatever they were all doing together is interrupted by this violent windstorm inside the house. Little flames rested on all of them, and if that were not strange enough, they started to speak in other languages. It's like that moment on a roller coaster when you've been going uphill slowly and you hear the little ratchets clicking as you get to the highest point, and then you roll over the top and everything picks up speed and you start tearing through turns and being thrown around a little bit. In our story, we see wind in the house, flames on people's heads, and now all of a sudden they're speaking languages they never learned in school. They spilled out into the public square in Jerusalem, and then we see the reactions of the people there, and that's the third part of our story. There were crowds of Jewish visitors to Jerusalem, part of that diaspora of Jewish believers throughout the entire Greek-speaking world. They were in town to see family or to offer prayers at the temple, and then they start to hear something strange. A crowd came together in bewilderment, the text says, because each one heard their own language being spoken. People from all over the diaspora, that mass migration of Jews over 6 or 7 centuries, they all heard their own local languages. Luke goes into detail here about the people of God from across the Western world who could hear the gospel, not in Greek and not in Hebrew, but in their heart language, the language of their history and family and identity. Parthians, it's gonna make me say all of these foreign names again. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene. Visitors from Rome, in other words, people who had come from Rome who were either Jews by birth or converts to Judaism. And then people from Crete and then Arabs from all over the Arab world. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own languages. All of these years later, we get to pause and ask the same question they did in that first crazy Pentecost. What does this all mean? I think this story of the coming of the Spirit and the birth of the church is making a theological statement, but it's also making a political statement. And here's why. Alexander controlled the world and imposed a standard language on every person as a way of controlling his empire, of extending his rule over the world of his day. Jesus sent the Holy Spirit so that everyone could hear the gospel in their own language. It was God's way of blessing his creation, of extending his loving reign over all places and people and times. Here's how you sum that up. Alexander's conquest and imposition of Greek tells us a lot about Alexander. The sacrifice of Christ and the gift of the Holy Spirit teaches us a lot about God. And so what do we learn about ourselves from the story of that first Pentecost? What do we learn about who we're called to be as the body of Christ? First, it's in the DNA of the church to learn new ways to communicate the gospel. From that very first day, God empowered people to find the heart language of their neighbors so they could share the gospel in meaningful ways. Think about what that means. Being people of faith means a lot of things, but one of them is that we are designed and called to share our faith stories in ways that speak to the hearts of our neighbors, even if we think our neighbors might be our enemies. Second, As long as the core message of the gospel stays intact, there are as many ways to communicate it as there are people or languages or cultures. The call on us is to learn how to share that gospel message with the people around us. There are all kinds of cultures and subcultures out there, and they're represented by language and music and literature and even movies. Pentecost reminds us that it's our job to go to them and not the other way around. Listen to this guy named Dave Gibbons. He describes the call on the church in his book. It's a book called The Monkey and the Fish. Listen to this quote. "Each generation must create a new language that connects with the soul and life of their community in their era. So while the message may stay the same, the forms change. Jesus himself modeled this. The Word, who had always been, became flesh." Jesus became human. That's what Dave is talking about. Jesus became human and showed us that there isn't any length he wouldn't go to share his saving message and welcome creation into his arms. And then finally, we learn that the saving message of the gospel is meant to unify us, to bring us together no matter what else might divide us. That message is always important, but it's especially important during a time of isolation and distancing. It also speaks to the divisive ways that Christian faith can be used as a weapon, as a way of stoking division and conflict and oppression in the hands of abusive people. We have all seen that. We continue to see that here in our nation. And so what about today? How much more do we need the healing, unifying work of the Holy Spirit as we bear witness to the love of Christ in a nation still torn apart by ethnic hatred? How much more do we need to learn the heart languages of our neighbors as we see the violent release of pent-up anger and frustration in our politics and in the ways that we interact socially? How much more, just in these past few weeks, how much more do we need to see the connection between our personal political views and the oppression of people in other countries, developing nations, past and present enemies, and in this past few weeks, even in Israel-Palestine? We need Pentecost today, more than ever. We need the Holy Spirit at this moment, in this critical moment in our history. We need the Holy Spirit to teach us the heart languages of our brothers and sisters who might not trust the gospel of Jesus Christ because they've only heard it in the language of conquest and domination and power. It's a good thing that God has already come through. God started this work through the ministry of Jesus Christ and the gift of the Holy Spirit, and now it's our turn. Alexander conquered the world and imposed a standard language on every person. Jesus sent the Holy Spirit so that everyone could hear the gospel in their own language. And now God calls us to take that message, empowered by the Holy Spirit, to a world that needs to hear those words and see our love more than anything else. Pentecost is not about conquering the world for Jesus Christ. Pentecost is about going out into the world that Christ has already redeemed and introducing it to the God who made them and died for them and loves them always. That's what Pentecost meant on that very first day. And that's what Pentecost means for us today. So maybe a homework statement for this week, maybe a homework assignment for all of us, is to look to our neighbors and see what it is about the way they live their lives, what is meaningful to them, and tying our own faith story to them rather than expecting them to do that for themselves. The gospel of Jesus Christ is meant to be shared in the heart language of our neighbors, of our brothers and sisters, even if they're our enemies. And so may God bless and keep you. May God wrap holy arms around you and heal you. May God bring health and reconciliation to this troubled world. And may God fill us all again with the Holy Spirit so that we can tell this story wherever we go. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for the ways that you draw us together. We thank you for the ways that you give us the gift of your Holy Spirit so that we can be your people and share your message with the world. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Let's respond to that through the giving of our tithes and pledges and offerings. Remember that as we reopen, we are looking forward to getting everything back to the way it was, including our giving. So we invite you to take these few moments and share generously with the church.
He is for you.
Wow, what a beautiful song. Let's respond to that and to the hearing of God's word by singing together our song of commitment, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Let's join together as we close our service today in the declaration of our mission together. You will see it on your screen in just a moment. There it is. Friends, what is our mission? Our mission is to glorify Jesus Christ and to be instruments of God's healing, reconciling, life-giving presence in the world. And so hear this benediction as we leave today. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the communion of the Holy Spirit we celebrate today be with each and every one of us each and every day. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Music. Bingo.